to you, and we'll see how we make progress throughout these coming months. Anything else to announce? Sharon?
Jean Haney's birthday is this week. Pastor's going to be visiting her on Tuesday and taking the cake and the balloon and the cards. The card is out in the Welcome Center. Anybody that wants to sign that so he can take that along with him Tuesday.
Thank you. We'll share the peace of Christ with one another right now. Praise and petitions that we can lift up this morning. Carl.
My father is in the hospital actually right now. He's ready for surgery.
Father in the hospital getting ready for surgery. Ask God to give skilled workers to help him out and bring him through that operation and be set on a road of recovery. Amy. Grandma, mm-hmm. Asking the Lord to continue to be present and active in their lives and as the end of life comes. Ginger. All the survivors of 9/11, we commend them to the Lord. Pray God's healing presence still to be active in their lives. Don Barr's mother, Frida, suffered a fall in the hospital, I think in Waco, so we ask the Lord to minister to her and to keep the family in his good care, work out his perfect purpose in her life. All this goes up to our Heavenly Father through Jesus, our priceless treasure. That's where we begin the singing. stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sin, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together, as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism, you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus, our support and defense in every need, continue to preserve your church in safety. Govern her by your goodness. Bless her with your peace. Testament reading this morning comes from the prophet Isaiah chapter 50. This is the third of the four servant songs. The Lord God gave me an educated tongue to know how to respond to the weary with a word that will awaken them in the morning. God awakens my ear in the morning to listen. Educated people do. The Lord God opened my ear. I did not rebel. I did not turn my back. Instead, I gave my body to attackers, my cheeks to beard pluckers. I did not hide my face from insults and spitting. The Lord God will help me. Therefore, I have not been insulted. Therefore, I set my face like flint, and I knew that I would not be ashamed. The one who will declare me innocent is near. Who will argue with me? Let us stand up together. Who will bring judgment against me? Let him approach me. Look, the Lord God will help me. Who will condemn me? Look, they will wear out like clothing. The moth will eat them. Who among you fears the Lord? Who listens to the voice of his servant, who walks in darkness and has no light? They will trust in the Lord's name and rely upon their God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading this morning comes from James 3. My brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers, because we know that we teachers will be judged more strictly. We all make mistakes often, but those who do not make mistakes with their words have reached full maturity. Like a bridled horse, they can control themselves entirely. When we bridle horses and put bits in their mouths to lead them wherever we want, we can control their whole bodies. Consider ships. They are so large that strong winds are needed to drive them. But pilots direct their ships wherever they want with a little rudder. In the same way, even though the tongue is a small part of the body, it boasts wildly. Think about this. A small flame can set a whole forest on fire. The tongue is a small flame of fire, a world of evil at work in us. It contaminates our entire lives. Because of it, the circle of life is set on fire. The tongue itself is set on fire by the flames of hell. People can tame, and already have tamed, every kind of animal, bird, reptile, and fish. But no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it, we both bless the Lord and Father and curse human beings made in God's likeness. Blessing and cursing come from the same mouth. My brothers and sisters, it just should not be this way. Both fresh water and salt water do not come from the same spring, do they? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree produce olives? Can a grapevine produce grapes? Of course not. And fresh water does not flow from a salt water spring either. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
We stand for the gospel reading. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus, Peter, James, and John approached the other disciples, they saw a large crowd surrounding them and legal experts arguing with them. Suddenly, the whole crowd caught sight of Jesus. They ran to greet him, overcome with excitement. Jesus asked them, "What are you arguing about?" Someone from the crowd responded, "Teacher, I brought my son to you, since he has a spirit that does not allow him to speak. Wherever it overpowers him, it throws him into a fit. He foams at the mouth, grinds his teeth, and stiffens up. So I spoke to your disciples to see if they could throw it out, but they could not." Jesus answered them, "You faithless generation, how long will I be with you? How long will I put up with you? Bring him to me." They brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a fit. He fell on the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked his father, "How long has this been going on?" He said, "Since he was a child. It has often thrown him into a fire or into water, trying to kill him. If you can do anything, help us. Show us compassion." Jesus said to him, "If you can do anything, all things are possible for the one who has faith." At that, the boy's father cried out, "I have faith. Help my lack of faith." Noticing that the crowd had surged together, Jesus spoke harshly to the unclean spirit. "Mute and deaf spirit, I command you to come out of him and never enter him again." After screaming and shaking the boy horribly, the spirit came out. The boy seemed to be dead. In fact, several people said that he had died. But Jesus took his hand, lifted him up, and he arose. After Jesus went into a house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not throw this spirit out?" Jesus answered, "Throwing this kind of spirit out requires prayer." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess the Christian faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We sing the hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Sometimes God's word speaks the truth too clearly and too personally. That's me on the tennis court. Me and my big mouth. An honest confession here. My tongue can become filthy in the heat of athletic competition. Mostly it's directed at myself when I fail to achieve, when I miss a shot, when I make a mistake, when I don't complete the play the way I know I can and I have before. Sometimes that spews in all directions. Despite my prior commitment every time before I walk on the court, this time I'm just going to keep my mouth shut. I'm going to control my temper. I'm going to harness my outburst. My tongue still gets loose with harsh language and destructive invective. It's a lifelong battle that I continue to lose, much to my shame. I know that it's a bad witness, a damaging witness, not consistent with my Christian identity. So along with the prophet Isaiah, who knew that he was a man of unclean lips, and along with St. Paul, who for a time was outspoken in condemning the church of Christ, and along with James, our writer today, who writes candidly about sinful speech, I am all too familiar with this little muscle that is a restless evil full of deadly poison. I know firsthand how the tongue is untamable, a world of evil at work in me. I know how it contaminates my entire life. And I bet some of you have the exact same problem. As much as you wish you could clean up your language and be godly in your speech, your tongue too is a flame of fire. As the old saying goes, do you eat with that mouth? Even worse, do you praise God with that same mouth? Do you curse and abuse the people and the nature and the things that God Himself created? So what do? Tape it over? If I did that, I would still somehow make myself heard. Can you put on one of these handy masks and have somebody sew it on permanently? Could you just cut your tongue out of your mouth and be done with it forever? All of these surely have been tried, but none of them have fixed the problem. What does it take? Maybe sheer willpower would help. Get control of your body, even this small instrument, and make it conform to what you want. It's worth the effort, and it can make a difference, at least for a while. But I've found inevitably the filth will spew out eventually. You can try substitute words, which will clean up your expressions and show that you're not giving in to the cultural slide. That at least distinguishes you from so much other casual vulgarity. However, the actual meaning of what you're saying and the anger behind it is still clear to everyone. You can develop new habits or new patterns. Something to take you out of the same old rut. It might mean excusing yourself from certain company. Could be making new friends who will have a positive influence on how you speak. Could even be turning away from activities that prompt the outburst. I have sometimes asked myself whether I should give up tennis, give up all sports, really any competition, since it causes me to sin. Even with all this in view, here's the biblical conclusion from James. No one can tame the tongue. So as with all our other sin, the first thing we do is confess it before God. We come with a full admission of our weakness, no cover-up of our wickedness, just a straight repentance that says, Lord, have mercy on me and forgive me. And that should happen as often as we slip and fall and misuse the gift God has given us. We lay it at the cross and pick up instead the cleansing and healing that Jesus gives. Set free to have another go of it in the power of His grace. Then James points this out. Just as a fig tree cannot produce olives and a grapevine cannot produce figs, neither can a saltwater spring produce fresh water. So, we need a different spring. The restoration and repair have to happen on the inside. The source has to be purified for the output to be different. The source on the inside has to be purified so that the output can be different. Which is exactly what the Holy Spirit does as He comes forth from Jesus. The Spirit is living water that washes and regenerates. The Spirit puts the Word of the Lord within us, the saving Word that transforms all of our thoughts and expressions. The Spirit brings the redemption of Christ to us so that we are formed and shaped in His image. Our actions take on the character of Jesus so that His holiness is heard and seen in what we say and do. The Spirit causes the water of life to bubble up within us so that our nature is made new and fresh, flowing with the love and kindness of Christ. With that, we make every effort to focus on what the Apostle Paul said. All that is excellent and admirable and true and holy and just and pure and lovely and worthy of praise. Let those be your constant influence. And we just might be able to bless the Lord and Father while also blessing human beings made in God's likeness. That's a life-giving spring that everyone can drink from. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses human understanding, guard your hearts and minds and tongues in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We stand for the prayer of the church. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, we believe. Help our unbelief. Sustain us through the many troubles and trials of this world when unclean spirits afflict us and those that we love. Revive our trust in you, Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, knowing that those who teach in the church will be judged with greater strictness, bless the teachers of our synod schools, colleges, and seminaries. Preserve them faithful to your word that they may not stumble in what they say. Lord, in your mercy. Lord and Father, tame our tongues so that they are not a restless evil full of deadly poison. Turn them by your Spirit from cursing the people made in your likeness to instead blessing you. And keep us from stumbling at what we say. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, guard the tongues of our governing authorities that they may not stumble in what they say, but speak wisely, leading in accord with your will. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you have promised that all things are possible for the one who believes. In such faith, we bring before you our loved ones among us who are in need, asking you to grant them health and healing. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, your Son, who suffered unjustly for our sins and was vindicated in his resurrection, is near to us in his body and blood. Assure us that no one can contend against or declare guilty those who have been reconciled to God in Christ. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen. You may be seated. As we have time, opportunity to bring our offerings to the Lord, we will hear the piano offertory. We give thee but thine own, whatever the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, O Lord, a trust from thee. We continue with the preface to the sacrament. We stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death, will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, shed for the remission of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it to remember me." Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Jesus Christ, who I love, God. You came with sin, O Lord. O Jesus Christ, who I love, God. Have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.